Now that we are done with the DNA structure, let's discuss how the DNA is replicated, or basically how do you synthesize DNA from an existing DNA strands. This is actually how the information, your genetic information, is passed through from parent to offspring. Okay, so the cell's genetic information consists of the order of the nucleotide bases, which is your DNA sequence, the nucleotide bases of the chromosomes. Descendant cells must get an exact copy of that information. Each chromosome is copied entirely. The two chromosomes that result are duplicates of your parent molecule. The DNA replication is an energy-intensive process by which the cell copies its DNA. That means that you are expending energy for every base that you add, you expend energy. Actually, it's an energy equivalent to an ATP molecule for every additional base that you add in your DNA strand. So the cell copies its DNA before it can reproduce. And each of the two DNA strands in a double helix is replicated. So the DNA replication requires many enzymes, including the DNA polymerase and other molecules. But the central figure here is usually the DNA polymerase, the one that's actually doing the enzyme responsible for adding new nucleotides to the growing strand. So how does the DNA replication works? First, remember your DNA is a double helix structure. If it's in a double helix formation, the bases cannot be accessed. Basically, that's how the DNA protects itself. That's how it's able to store information without destroying that information, because the DNA is base paired. Because of the base pairing, the information inside is not easily accessible. And in order to replicate that, you must be able to access the bases. And that is that is the role of your helicase. A helicase is an enzyme that breaks the hydrogen bonds between the DNA strands. So once you break the hydrogen bonds, your strands that the DNA strands will separate. It will become open now. And the bases inside are accessible. Remember, the order of the bases is the one that encodes the information. Now, since it's a double helix structure, when the DNA unwinds, or rather, when the DNA strands basically separate, it produces a tension or a strain in the strand that is unwound, because again it's twisted, so there's a strain. So you have topoisomerases to untwist your double helix. This is in order to ease the strain and prevents breakage, because once the DNA breaks, if you have a double strand that breaks in the DNA, it's actually a very large problem. So the DNA polymerase joins three nucleotides into the new strands of DNA. So each requires a primer to initiate your DNA synthesis. So what is a primer? A primer is a short single strand of DNA or RNA that is complementary to a targeted DNA sequence. And then we also have your ligase. So ligase joins DNA segments in a discontinuous strand. So basically, this is how a DNA is how you start the replication of a DNA. First, again, you unwound the helix, so you separate the two strands, and you add a primer on your strand. So the primer is usually for cellular replication. The primer is RNA. So the primer is added because polymerases can only add to the already present growing strand, but it cannot add a nucleotide from nothing. So you have establishment of base pairing between DNA or RNA cells. So that is hybridization. So because this is one is DNA, the other is RNA, it's called hybridization. So it is a spontaneous process driven entirely on hydrogen bonding. So you hybridize the primer to your DNA. Once your primer is added, you can now start the replication. The DNA replication is considered semi-conservative. What do you mean by semi-conservative? Semi means half, and then conservative because you are conserving the old strands. So each strand of the DNA double helix is a template for the synthesis of the complementary strand of the DNA. So one template builds DNA continuously and the other builds DNA discontinuously in segments. So each new DNA molecule consists of an old strand and a one new strand. That is the semi-conservative replication. So in here, you can see this is your replication, the steps in replication. So you have your initiator proteins to tell you where to start the replication step. So this is your replication bubble. Now, this is your DNA strand, downstream site. So you have topoisomerase that helps untwist your double helix. So once it's untwisted, you have your helicases that breaks the hydrogen bonds between the bases. Once they are separated, your primers can now hybridize to the open bases, and your polymerase, this is the polymerase, can add to the growing strand. So now, remember, the DNA is an anti-parallel. The two strands of the DNA are in an anti-parallel position. That is why, it's an anti-parallel. One strand goes by 5' to 3', and the other strand goes from 3' to 5'. Now, unfortunately, polymerase can only add new strands in one direction, 5' to 3'. So it can only add strands from the 5' position to the 3' position. That means there's only, since it's anti-parallel, one strand continuously, as the DNA is being unwound, it just follows the helicase. It continuously adds bases following the direction of the unwinding. However, the other strand is goes in the opposite direction, because again, only 5' to the 3' position. Now, the one that goes in the opposite position has to do a discontinuous replication. So it forms fragments, or the way of replication of that site is fragmented, and we call those fragments as Okazaki fragments. Now, in the final not exactly the final step, but those fragments are then joined together by the ligase. The ligase is somewhat like a glue. It joins a single-stranded breaks in the DNA. So this is your ligase. So this is one Okazaki fragment. So this is the DNA polymerase that is moving in the opposite direction. And this is the primary. So after it finishes this one, it jumps to the next one and then goes in this direction. And then afterwards, when this part is unwound, so another primer will attach, and then the polymerase will again add strands in the opposite direction from the direction of the helicase. So this is the discontinuous replication. And this one just follows along the helicase. You form a single continuous strand. So this is the replication of your DNA. So basically, a closer look. So this is the 5'. So again, the DNA, the polymerase can only add to the 5' to the 5' to 3' position. So this one is discontinuously. This is growing discontinuously. And this one is just going continuously from the other, because they are they're being added in the opposite direction of the unwinding of your DNA strand. So how does one adds bases? It is through the hydroxyl group of the 3' carbon. So 3' to 5'. So that's why it's called 3' to 5'. So you have the incoming strand 5'. The phosphates in the 5', it attaches to the oxygen in the 3' position. So that is your DNA replication. Okay, now, problems with replication, or rather, mutations happen because of incorrect replication of the DNA. So DNA polymerases it's difficult to avoid errors. Although the rate of errors in DNA is very, very, very small. So I think it's just 1 in over several million bases. But our DNA is around 3 billion. So it spontaneously commit errors. And in order to prevent long-lasting mutations, DNA polymerases can proofread DNA sequences during replication and even the repair of damaged DNA. So when proofreading and repair mechanisms fail, an error becomes a mutation. It becomes permanent. It's a permanent change in the DNA sequence. So what are the possible causes of mutation? So they are usually exposure to chemicals that can cause replication errors. We call those chemicals carcinogens. Because the mutations, the eventual effect of mutations mutations can cause tumors, and then later on it becomes cancer. Other causes of mutation are free radicals, UV radiation, especially because UV radiation, they are ionizing radiation and they produce pyrimidine dimers. And then we also have ionizing, again, UV radiation is also an ionizing radiation. So other types of ionizing radiation that can knock electrons out of atoms or break the DNA into pieces. So here is an example of a mutation. So this is the original strand or the original DNA sequence. Now, there's a change in the T, D becomes A. So, this base change is, for example, if it was not repaired properly, and this this mutated strand undergoes replication, so one strand is okay, the other strand, so one strand is okay, the other strand, the change or the error persists. And then if this strand is replicated again, the mutation is persists on the succeeding generations. So mutations, these are this is another type of mutation. These are breaks in the DNA. So you can see here, or rather, these are chromosomes, chromosomal breaks. So there's a break in the chromosomal breaks in the chromosomes per se. So what are the direct effects? So for example, in flowers, you have a normal flower, and these are mutated versions. Okay, so this is usually found it especially in the Chernobyl, if you remember the Chernobyl nuclear power plant accident. So the areas are near that nuclear power plant, most of the organisms in that, cows growing two heads, for instance, you have flowers, even different animals that showing very grotesque appearance because of the mutations. Now, you have your, in here, this is a normal flower, it's a 5-petaled flower. And due to mutations, it can grow multiple number of petals. So, different numbers of petals. So, that is the effect of mutations. Now, mutations can occur in any cell and can alter any part of the cell's DNA. So, those that arise in the formation of the gametes, which is the eggs and the sperm cells, they can be passed on to the offspring. So, mutations, they are often harmful, but they may also give rise to variation in traits. And that is, according to the theory of evolution, that's how, allegedly, how organisms evolve. Okay, so in the next discussion, we will discuss about cloning.